everybody. Today I am going to talk a little bit about a book that I recently picked up and finished, and I think it is the first book that I have read translated from Japanese. So my first step into Japanese literature, and that is the Decagon House Murders by Yukito Ayatsuji. I have no idea if I'm pronouncing that anywhere near correct, so could be a theme throughout this video, but I picked this up from a little free library, actually. Had never heard of it, but the title was intriguing, so I grabbed it, and then it seemed interesting, and so I read it within a few days of having grabbed it. So this story was kind of written and was originally published in Japan in 1987. Then I think there was an updated edition of it in 2007, and then this English translation came out a few years after that. And it was the first English translation and was translated by Ho-Ling Wong into English from Japanese. And so I think this was kind of this author and some other writers wanting to take mystery fiction, murder mysteries, kind of back to the Golden Age mystery style, so like Agatha Christie type thing. And this was one of their kind of first books reintroducing this style of mystery. So that was kind of where this story came from. And so it is written as like a direct tribute, I think, to And Then There Were None by Agatha Christie. And they bear a lot of similarities. So if you've read And Then There Were None, then this, if you read it, will have a lot of overlay. So it involves 7 students who end up going to this Decagon house, where a few months previously, about 6 months before, the owner of the Decagon house and his wife and some other people died on the island in the main house. So the Decagon house is, I'm not sure if it was like a guest house, what it was actually designed for, but there is the Decagon house, but the main mansion and things burned down, and they never found a murderer, but there was a man who was missing and presumed to be the murderer. And then these students who are at a local university were all members of a mystery fiction kind of club, reading club and writing. They decide to go there when one of them has a family connection that can kind of get them on the island, and they decide to go there as kind of a retreat. And they all have nicknames based on famous mystery novelists and characters and things. So one of the girls goes by Agatha for Agatha Christie. One of them goes by Ellery, I think. One of them is Van. Can't remember all of them. Poe for Edgar Allan Poe. So there are, you know, nicknames for all of these characters. So they go there, and then if you're familiar with And Then There Were None, they're kind of set on this island, and there's not really any way off once they're on it, because they're going to be picked up like in a week. And then they get some ominous messages that let them know that there might be some murders coming, and it kind of turns them all on each other. So that's kind of the basic setup for it. And I enjoyed it. I'm glad that I read it, but it's not a new favorite or anything. Part of it might be the translation. I don't know, not knowing Japanese, I don't know how Japanese would read. And if this is like a more direct translation, then maybe it reads like, it reads smoothly in Japanese, but the direct translation in English does not, because this is a little bit stilted at times. And so that kind of kept me from being super invested in the story. It also, like, the formatting, which probably has some to do with the translation, but the formatting is a little bit weird at times as far as, like, paragraph breaks. So there'll be, like, text and then, like, a description or, like, explaining how the person looks who's speaking, but it'll be a separate paragraph, and then there'll be, like, another paragraph where they're speaking. And a lot of those kind of switches, especially when there were more than one person speaking, got confusing on whose description it was being given. Like, was it the first person who spoke? Were both tags of dialogue the same character? Some of that got a little bit confusing, and I would have to read it through a couple of times to see who it seemed like was supposed to actually be talking. Some of the descriptions as far as the characters were also a little bit, I don't know, just a little bit odd to me. And the way that they would like react, like they would, you know, shout or scream out and various things. And that didn't seem to fit the story extremely well. So there were little things like that that I was just a little nitpicky with, not enjoying. But as far as like the mystery went, I did enjoy it. The thing that I would say kind of holds this back, I'm not trying to directly compare this to And Then There Were None. I know that it was kind of written as a tribute to that, and I think that that's cool. But like the thing that kind of holds this in a lesser light for me is the fact that in And Then There Were None, there's all these people on this island for various reasons, but they don't know each other. And I think that that adds like an extra layer to the mystery. These people are all friends, and so the fact that they know each other and then all of this stuff is happening, there's just some portions of that that don't seem to fit and with how people might react to things. So that part of it didn't really fit. There's also a couple of things in this, like where there's a story happening on the island and then some happening like on the mainland. And I understand why both are needed, especially when we get to the conclusion and everything. But I found that a little bit jarring going back and forth. Like I would have rather stay on the island and see exactly what's happening there than getting some of the side information, although important to the story. The reading experience of that was not great for me. This is also a lot of tell and not show, which is fine. Like, I don't necessarily think that everything always has to be shown. Especially with this type of story, I think that telling, if it's done in a compelling way, can be very good. But in this one, I found it to be a little bit jarring and stiff rather than a flowing, let me tell you what happened type of thing. So I did find that the style just didn't work extremely well for me. Like I said, though, I did think that it was worth reading and I did enjoy it, and it kept me invested enough that I read it in a few days. And so I think that you could enjoy it if you really like mysteries and if you kind of want a tribute to Agatha Christie. So if you read it, let me know what you think. And if not, let me know if you're thinking about it, and I'll see you next time.